Supra. Ever heard of it? For 25 years now, it's been Jay-Z this and Jay-Z that. But what is so special about that 2JZ engine? First, a little background. Toyota makes a whole family of inline six-cylinder engines called JZs. How Toyota names all their engines is actually really interesting. You should look that up sometime later. But we'll talk about what we need to know for the 2JZ GTE. Anyways, there are three 2.5-liter inline six engines called 1JZs, and there are three 3-liter variants called 2JZs. So there is the first reason why the 2JZ is pretty popular. The larger displacement to 3 liters simply means more horsepower than a 2.5-liter engine. And who doesn't want more horsepower? I want more horsepower. But in the late 1980s and early 90s, bad car accidents were getting out of hand in Japan, and everyone there thought that speed was the major factor. So Japanese domestic market automakers made an informal promise to each other that they wouldn't sell any cars with more than 280 horsepower. It was called a gentleman's agreement, and it was ignored by everybody pretty quickly. Much the way Nolan repeatedly ignores his gentleman agreement to pay me back for money's owed.
Hey, Bart.
What's up, Eddie?
What about the RB?
RB? Yeah, dude. I love RBs. You go, get me a big Montana. I'll keep rolling. Look, everybody knows speed doesn't really hurt. It's the sudden stops that get you. At the same time automakers all promised not to jump into a horsepower war, the exchange rate was really favorable for the yen. If you're an econ kind of car nerd, check out James talking about the LS400! But in Japan's recession, it wasn't a big stretch for Toyota to spend a lot of money on an engine development and quality materials. So that's what Toyota did. And as a result, they ended up with some overbuilt engines that could easily make over 280 horsepower anyway. They were built so well, they could make double or nearly triple that without having to do significant engine work. The Toyota 2JZ GTE engine is the most notorious example of this. At its core, the 2JZ GTE is a twin-turbo, 3-liter inline six-cylinder engine with an iron block and an aluminum head. So, 2JZ, 3-liter inline six, G, performance wide-angle valve, dual overhead cam, T, turbocharged, E, electronic fuel injection. Those are all very good things to have if you want to make more horsepower. Both fuel injection systems and turbos are pretty easy to tune and upgrade. And since it's an inline six, the primary and secondary forces that are generated by the movement of the pistons cancel out, making it a naturally smooth running and balanced engine. It also leaves extra space in the engine bay to get your hands dirtier and install bigger turbos. You want to know more about all that stuff I just said? Check out our episode on inline six versus V6s. American market Supras were sold with bigger fuel injectors, stronger turbos, and different cams than the JDM cars. That helped them make 320 horsepower at 5,600 RPM and 315 foot-pound of torque at 4,000 RPM. In its stock form, the 2JZ uses a sequential turbo setup. The first turbo spools up around 1,800 RPM, and then the second turbo starts making boost around 4,000. This kind of setup reduces turbo lag. But to make the biggest horsepower numbers, tuners swap the twin turbo setup for one big turbo. And that sacrifices the spool up time, but a bigger turbo can make more boost than two smaller ones. And that helps the engine make peak power. Making more power is pretty dang easy. You upgrade to a better flowing intake, better flowing exhaust, a big single turbo, bigger front mount intercooler to replace the stock side mount intercooler, higher flowing external wastegate, bigger fuel injectors, fuel lines, fuel pump, and an ECU tune. If you're gonna make huge power, you're gonna need a strong engine. A lot of times, if you wanna unlock the hidden potential of an engine, you gotta get in there, reinforce a bunch of stuff, swap out some cams, replace all your valves and gaskets, and you know, time-consuming, dirty, dirty stuff. The fact that Toyota over-engineered the 2JZ is the main reason that it's so easy to bolt up a huge turbo and make 800 horsepower. The cast iron engine block is, well, cast iron, which is really heckin' strong material. The block also has a fully closed deck. And that means, unlike some other inline engines, the area around the cylinders is completely filled in, except for some coolant passages. And that gives the block extra strength and really keeps it from cracking when it's running high, high boost levels. The engine's crankshaft is made out of ultra strong forged steel, so it can easily deal with all those extra forces caused by making more power. The seven main bearing caps that hold the crankshaft in place as it spins are also massively strong. You see where I'm going with this? Straight out of the Toyota factory, the 2JZ can take a licking. Engines that are built using more modest components would have to be torn down to upgrade all the components that could fail under higher stress of more power. I mentioned earlier that the cylinder head is aluminum, which is lightweight and helps dissipate heat much more quickly. The pistons are also cast aluminum, and they have slightly dished tops. That gives the 2JZ GTE engine a lower compression ratio than the less popular 2JZ cousins in the family. And while sometimes lower compression can mean lower performance, a benefit of lower compression from the factory is that it makes it easier to safely run more turbo boost. Another unique feature of the 2JZ GTE is that there's oil squirters in the lower halves of the cylinder. They spritz a bit of oil on the bottom of the piston to keep them more lubricated and reduce friction. There's over twice as many lubricating ports in the 2JZ compared to some of its nearest competitors. At high engine speed, that helps keep the engine temperatures a bit cooler and helps keep the pistons lubricated so they don't break down. Jeez. Check out our video on engine oils to absorb more info on that. Man, that's gotta be it. That's so much stuff. No, wait, there's more. This engine's also got a high capacity oil pump and cooling system. Do you see where I'm going? The engine is made to withstand mind-boggling abuse. JDM Toyota's got variable valve timing in 98, but the US didn't. You wanna know more about valve timing? Check out the video on VTEC. Turns out people are just fine with the non-VVT 2Js because it's a non-interference engine. So if you're running at 6,000 RPM and the timing belt breaks, a non-interference engine means the pistons won't smash up into your valve. With variable valve timing, it doesn't always know that the belt broke. So the piston is still driving up, the valve might be pushed down to open, and kaboom, you got a bent valve. The non-VVT 2JZ is not a valve bender, which means if the belt breaks or you skip a tooth, you don't gotta get inside there and replace all the valves, which is both pricey and time consuming. So why all the love on the 2JZ GTE? It was a beautifully designed, over-engineered cast iron behemoth that, because of its inline design, is somehow still elegant. It feels like the engineers designing it took into consideration every possible condition that could damage an engine, and they designed around all of them. They created a nearly bulletproof inline six, and people love it so much that there's immeasurable aftermarket parts, forums, and assistant if you want to start working on one. Now, we're all jazzed up because there's some cars coming off the line in the last few years making ballpark 800 horsepower. There have been 2JZs reportedly boosted and tuned to 6, 7, and yeah, even 800 horsepower with stock internals, and even more when you swap out them guts. 2JZ engine. Subscribe to Donut, guys. That's how we get to do such awesome stuff for you. It means a lot. We got new merchandise in our store. Go to shop.donut.media. Check out this video from James on the Supra. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram @DonutMedia, and follow me @BidsBardo. Don't tell my wife I 2JZ swapped everything.